as I say here, what I'm referring to is not the destruction of the Republican Party's ability to win political contests. If anything, conservatives had always been really good at that, and they've only gotten better over time. What I'm referring to is the ability of the Republican Party to rule, that is to say, to govern. And that capacity, I think, has been destroyed by the marginalization of moderates from the Republican Party. The moderates had historically been the brains of the party. They were the ones coming up with the alternatives to Democratic programs that would address real problems. They were the ones who were able to find compromise with the Democrats to actually pass this legislation through into reality. And I think what we've certainly seen over the past time is that as the Republicans have become more and more intransigent, yes, they've stopped the Democrats from passing significant legislation. The Democrats are going to do exactly the same thing to the Republicans if the Republicans win control of Congress or the presidency. And furthermore, it's not clear to a lot of people out there in the political world whether the Republicans really have a coherent program aside from reducing everything that might benefit Democratic constituencies and giving as much money as possible to those that benefit Republican constituencies. So, you know, it used to be said that the moderates, the Rockefeller Republicans, if you will, were out on a program of rule or ruin. That's what you heard from a lot of conservatives in that era. You're just a rule or ruin person. You don't mind if you take the party down. But I think what we've had over time is rule and ruin. In other words, the Republicans have won a lot of elections but have achieved less and less once they've got those elections and have taken those offices. And that's the phenomenon that I was examining in this book.
It's an interesting concept. You know, since Eisenhower was first elected, you know, and the measurement that you don't get to govern unless you win. And so there's a shifting coalition. I mean, it's just the reality of democracy. And there's a shifting coalition that's taken place as to who serves in it. It's not just geographic, it's demographic as well. And clearly the Democrat Party that was a conservative party when Lyndon Johnson basically was running as a senator and became the majority leader of the Senate, and all obviously changed dramatically when he became the president in the tragedy of the Kennedy assassination, and pushed through the Kennedy, which was sort of the tail end of the Roosevelt revolution. And I think to a certain extent the Republican Party felt that those programs were beyond affordable, and I think that was sort of the battleground. And you know, you in your book you sort of diminish the Reagan presidency. The Reagan presidency really was the change presidency. It was really the presidency that came in and altered the dynamics. Eisenhower, who was obviously a great American hero and won two landslides, there wasn't a dramatic change when you look at the administrations there wasn't any undoing of anything that basically had been part of the Roosevelt administration. When Nixon was elected in 68 in a very narrow victory, he didn't try and undo any of the Great Society programs of Johnson. So it really wasn't until Reagan that basically came in, and obviously, and most analysts today would say he was the dramatic change agent, and he was the one who basically took a party that was in ruins in 1976 and rebuilt it and moved it forward with three landslides in a row.
Dwight Eisenhower was elected in massive margins in two successive elections. Dwight Eisenhower had a much more conservative older brother named Edgar. And Edgar was one of the people who said, "Dwight, I don't understand it. You know, the Republican Party has finally got the presidency after decades of Roosevelt and the New Deal. Why don't you repeal the New Deal? Isn't this what Republicans have been calling for all the time?" And he had a couple of other choice words to say about how his brother should really be repealing Social Security legislation, aid to farmers, and so forth. And Dwight wrote back a fairly diplomatic letter to his brother. He said, you know, there is a small group of people in the Republican Party that thinks you can repeal the New Deal and these other kind of securities. Their number is negligible and they are stupid. His point being that if you actually tried to take away these securities to which the American people had become accustomed, things like Social Security, that would not be a conservative act, that would be a radical act. You'd essentially be overturning the status quo that people had come to like and accept. He wasn't going to do that. But that doesn't mean that he was an uncritical believer in the New Deal and thought that he should just do everything that Franklin Roosevelt wanted him to do. What he really thought was that the government needed to run and live within its means. And, you know, Dwight Eisenhower is a favorite punching bag of conservatives even to this day. And in fact, the conservative movement was created in the mid-50s to oppose Dwight Eisenhower and his works. But the fact remains, and it's an uncomfortable fact, that for all we hear about fiscal conservatism from the Tea Party and their ilk, Dwight Eisenhower was the most fiscally conservative president we've had in the past 80 years. He is the only president to have balanced the budget three times during his 8 years as president. He is the only president to have reduced overall federal civilian employment. He is the only president under whom the debt as a percentage of GDP was reduced from the beginning of his presidency to the end. You would think this actually would be an appealing model. But because he wasn't a radical, because he didn't want to go in and uproot the New Deal, he was therefore criticized by conservatives in his party. And eventually, they got their way. They overthrew the people who had supported Dwight Eisenhower, the moderate factions in the Republican Party. The result was the nomination of Barry Goldwater. What was the result of the 1964 elections? It was the reduction of the Republican Party across the entire nation to levels unseen since the nadir of the Depression. This gave Lyndon Johnson the margin that he needed to push through a second New Deal. He was emancipated from the restraints of the Southern Democrats. He was able to get basically anything that he wanted during that period. Although the moderates even fought him tooth and nail, the moderates essentially believed that there were social programs, social problems, that Republicans needed to respond to much as Democrats needed to respond to them, but that they had to address these problems in the basically way that Dwight Eisenhower or his shade would approve, in a way that was not going to build up bureaucracy, not going to build up government centralization, not going to take undue freedoms away from the people. This idea that the moderate Republicans were simply liberal Democrats in disguise, I think, is nonsense. And Ronald Reagan, just to complete the last part of the trilogy that you're painting there, is somebody who did, in fact, reunite the Republican Party, made it seem much more viable electorally than it had seemed at the tail end of the 1970s. But Ronald Reagan was a big tent Republican. He wanted the votes of moderates. He wanted to include them as an important part of his coalition. He had warned his fellow conservatives ever since the time he was governor of California in the 1960s that it was better not to stand on principle and go down in a blaze of glorious defeat. And therefore, although Ronald Reagan undoubtedly did take the country in a more conservative direction, keep in mind that he had the support of moderate Republicans while he did that and was able to master the tensions within a party in the way that no president on the Republican side has been able to since him, and that few Republicans nowadays seem to have any interest in doing.
Well, first of all, the economic times of Eisenhower were extraordinary times for the country and extraordinary times for the world, so it was much easier to balance budgets. There were no new programs. The highway program was paid for. They cut back dramatically on defense. So obviously that's a different environment. Elections basically are change entities, and I think there's many people look back, including myself, I think Dwight David Eisenhower was a great American. I think he was a great president. I think people are reflecting back on his presidency in a very positive way. He basically made it look easy, and I think to a certain extent was a grandfatherly figure and a great American hero. Obviously in the 60s, there's circumstances that take place from time to time. No one was going to beat Lyndon Johnson in 1964 after the Kennedy assassination. Absolutely no one was going to do that. I don't care whether it's Barry Goldwater or Richard Nixon or anybody else. That was basically carrying out the mantle of the assassinated president, which was one of the most dramatic events in most of our lives that are in this room here. So it's not like you can say that good old Lyndon Johnson ran on these great programs, and therefore everybody basically turned out to, Goldwater was an extreme candidate and basically was the foundation, though, certainly for a grassroots movement that basically took away the old political power of the bosses of the Northeast.